like, I'm in heels right now, but I remember when we met at, here, stand up. When okay. This is like my real height. We were in a party at, it was at Chelsea's house?
Yes, it was at Chelsea's birthday party.
All I was like, I had you in a corner, and I was like, me, 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 me. And I was like, I have someone cornered who's a foot taller than me. we were talking about flower beauty. And yes. I brought you a whole bunch today.
Yes, yes, you're right. My favorite lip gloss.
Because that's what girls do at parties. If you were ever wondering, the cliche is true. We were sitting around talking about lip gloss and all things girly and feminine.
Yes.
And it is Mother's Day.
Yes,
it so, is. How would you like to celebrate Mother's Day? Like, ideally, no BS, total honesty. What would your ideal Mother's Day be?
Truthfully, if we could just, like, go to a park, have a sunny day, and hang out, it'd be great. Maybe or maybe not, you know, have a little bit of wine. I don't know. It depends on the time of day. And also, we got my daughter this kite. And anytime it's like windy outside, I'll look out the window. I'm like, get the kite. And we're like determined. We're determined to fly this thing. So if there was sunny day, a little bit of wind.
Wind, wine.
Wind, wine,
and
kite.
We'll fight. Yeah, wind, wine, and kite. Do you also have a one-year-old?
I do.
A little boy.
Yes.
And
who was born right before, you know, the pandemic started.
February.
So he was born in February, and then everything started going crazy with the pandemic. My last book. You and I's mothers, which were, you know, Mother's Day.
I mean, this
right.
book?
Yes, yes. Yeah,
I like this book that I happen to have right here. Mm-hmm.
So that book came out in April. So he was born in February. Everything with the pandemic got crazy. And then I started my, then became, you know, an online press tour for that book that came out. So between the book tour and bonding with my son and, you know, my husband and my daughter and all of us as a family, It was very surreal. But what was great was it was a lot easier for me to run up and feed my baby and then run back and
yes.
do an interview or go back up and, you know, be with my family or, you know, prepare food quickly for my daughter or whatever it was. Being able to be so close at that time really, really helped.
Did you have this at all? On my first kid, Olive, I just didn't care about anything. Everything seemed so trivial compared
right.
to this baby. Like, I couldn't focus. I didn't care. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know my place in the world anymore except for this little thing.
I totally understand. And that did happen with me. And after the birth of my daughter, I didn't know what was going on. I was like, I struggle. And I rarely struggle from anxiety. That's not something that I do. Like, I've taken a lot of risks. And I would do things that weren't really safe. Like, I used to do some things that probably most people were like, wow, that's really dangerous, climbing a mountain or riding a motorcycle or whatever it was. When I first became a mom, I was like, this is what real stress is. Because you have, for me, it was like my heart outside of my body and I couldn't protect this thing. And I struggled so much with like, how do I protect this precious little baby from the world? I was really scared. And at the time I was living on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. And every, like, fire trucks roaring up the street, and I would hear, like, a fire truck, and I would think that something was, like, a threat to my family. Like, I was really hyper-vigilant.
I had the exact same experience, and I think we were similar. Like, you climbed Mount Kilimanjaro, right?
Yes, I did.
I mean, that is crazy. So basically what this boils down to is you climb Kilimanjaro, you're a thrill seeker. I would, you know, skydive and swim with sharks.
Great!
You did crazy
things.
It's
so much fun.
The funnest. Thank you for sharing how scary it is to have a baby, too. I don't feel like that's the talk.
And people don't
terrifying.
Talk about it. Yeah.
You don't eat, you don't sleep. I felt like I was going to vomit every 5 seconds. I've never felt a feeling like that.
It's just being able to talk about it and feel like you're less alone.
Yeah.
And I think that that is so important. And building community is something that I really take to heart, and it's just so important.
Well, how did you multitask everything? I mean, now you have a kitchen line, so
yes.
like, you know, you're writing books, you're going on press tours, you're having kids, you're a director, you're doing everything.
Sure.
How did the kitchen line come on?
Well, I've been cooking since I was a kid. I mean, my mother was a gourmet chef, and I've been cooking really as a youngster. I would watch her in the kitchen. But what's interesting is her way of cooking was very, she was a very eccentric chef, so she would make things like Peking duck and with like a
Wait, tell me that story about the Peking duck.
Well, this is just an example of the type of things that she would cook and like makeshift in the kitchen. So she loved cuisine that was very hard to kind of to do, right? So she would get a duck and she would blow, first of all, she would sew up any hole in the skin. You have to, I know you, this sounds gross, you guys, but you have to sew it up so that the air can't get out. So she's sewing the duck. And then the other thing she would do was she tried a fireplace billow to you stick into a little hole to get, because you have to get the skin away from the meat so the skin gets crispy. So the fireplace billow was a huge disaster. So then she took a bicycle pump.
Right, up the cavity.
Yes, so you leave a little slit in the skin and she slices the, sticks the bicycle pump in there and starts pumping air into this duck from a bicycle pump. She gets the air, she gets the skin away from the meat, she unravels a wire hanger, she gets the hanger through the duck's head, which was not pleasant to watch as a youngster, and then she hangs it in her closet.
For how long?
She hangs it in her closet with a fan blowing on it, so at least a day, at least a day.
Is that why you see all the Peking ducks like in the window?
Well, that's what she was trying to create in her closet.
Right.
So, but I grew up, and of course her Peking duck was like incredible.
Did she like enhance your palate though? Do you think you're a more-
100%, but she would never be present with the family. She was never there. She was always cooking. So she would create these beautiful dishes and was never there with her kids to enjoy any of it. So even as a kid, I was like, there's gotta be a better way. And that really is the impetus. I've been dreaming of my culinary line for years. And really the core is I wanna help people be more efficient in the kitchen so we can have more time together with our loved ones. That really is the crux of it for me. So all of my products, they're solution-based. They save you time in the kitchen. They're also really fun to use. And that really is the heart of the brand for me. Like I came up with this line. HSN is an incredible partner, and it's just been so awesome.
And someone else who I know you love that I'm obsessed with, Ina Garten.
Oh my gosh, the best. She's the best.
Why is she the best? Because I think so too. You know what? I think it's time for a garden party. Do you want to try a garden party?
Oh my gosh, that's awesome.
The reason I love her is because I find her cookbooks also to be something you can follow. A lot of cookbooks, as a cookbook enthusiast, make me feel like a little bit of a failure sometimes.
Right.
Hers, I always feel like, even if it comes out a little different, it's okay, I feel really empowered.
Totally, that's a great word. Because it's, you feel like, by the way, when it's done, it's always a beautiful dish. Like even her book, Cook Like a Pro, I'm just like, because as a home chef, I want to cook like a pro.
I have every single one of her cookbooks. Ina Garten, if you are out there.
I know, seriously,
by the way,
Ina.
I love, like, I'm right under her. There we go. We want to push on social media. We've never done this before.
Great.
Some might call it harassment. Some might call it a social experiment.
Borderline.
But we all want you to join this Ina Garten Love Fest on social media, and if you use the hashtag, if you use the hashtag Drew's Garten Party to tell us what you adore about the Barefoot Contessa, like, let's do this. I would give anything to have a Laura Prepon, Drew Barrymore, Ina Garten Garten Party here.
Oh my gosh, that would be.
Could it ever happen?
That would be incredible.